Okay, so the next speaker before the coffee break is Olivier Bousquet. Olivier Bousquet is PhD in mechanical technique. Then he moved to the MPI. And then he moved to a startup and eventually got to Google Zurich, where he now leads the machine learning team Google Research.
Thank you. Thanks for the introduction and thanks for having me here. So David yesterday said that because this is a workshop, it's okay to present half-baked ideas. So that's what I'm gonna do. Actually, I initially wanted to talk about the polished ID, the boosting aspect of GANs, and I thought, okay, maybe I sneak in some more half-baked ideas about convexity before that. So we'll see whether we have time to go through both topics, but I'll start with the half-baked one and we'll see where we end up. And this is joint work with a bunch of other folks, some of which are here. And hopefully it works. Okay, maybe I can do it manually. So this is the plan for the talk. So basically I'll talk about what I call generative density estimation. I don't know if it's an accepted term, but that's one way to frame GAN in the context of density estimation, but with a generative point of view. And I'll talk about what kind of distances on probability metrics or on probability measures you want to use in this context, and what are their properties, and what does it have to do with convexity. And then I'll say, well, if you want to boost these models, what you have to do, and in particular, I'll present an algorithm for doing that. So let's start with density estimation. Okay, this is a very well-known framework. You have data, samples, x1, xn, that are sampled from some unknown distribution, and you want to fit a model to those observations. And for that, you need some measure of distance between your model and the true data. Usually you use the callback divergence or something else. And the point is that you want to be able to estimate this criterion based on your data. And because we have, we are in the big data era, we usually have lots of data. And that induces some constraints on what you can do practically. And what happens in practice is that, if you use KL or if you use maximum likelihood and stochastic gradient descent, then you can solve that problem relatively efficiently. So more precisely, if you look at how you can write the callback divergence between the true data and your model, you can rewrite it in this way. And the important point here is to notice that, okay, besides this quantity here, which is the entropy of the true data that you don't know, but you don't care because you don't optimize with respect to P, you only optimize with respect to Q theta. The point here is that this is a linear function of P. And because it's an expectation under P, right? And because it's an expectation under P, then you can easily, when you take the gradient of this quantity, you can get easily an unbiased estimate of the gradient by taking the gradient of what's inside the integral on the data points. Really? So in some sense, that's exactly what makes it work, this whole business, and makes it possible to do stochastic gradient descent, is because you have this form of a linear function of P, because your criterion is linear in P, you can write it in such a way that you can approximate the gradients easily by computing it on data points. So now, you may wonder, can we generalize this idea? And can we do it with other criteria? So in general, that if you translate that into what are the constraints you want to satisfy, basically you need some sort of distance between P and Q that is, okay, let's say non-negative, and zero when you are at the optimum, like when P equals Q. And you want some form like this, where D of PQ is some function of P that you don't care about, and some integral over P of something that depends on Q. If you have this form, then it's easy to do this trick of approximating the gradient with stochastic gradient descent. That's the key point here is linearity in P of the part that depends on Q. Here I wrote out what it means to satisfy those constraints with this particular generic form. It in particular implies that f of p has a specific form if you want to have the zero here. And you can work out some other constraints on this little f function that you have to use. Essentially, you know, it has to be convex, then everything works. But okay, so this is just you know, a motivation. And now you want to generalize this further, and you'll see I'll come to GAN in a minute, but just to give you the idea, you know, we mentioned that linearity is what makes everything work, but you know, we don't have to use just one linear function. We can take several linear functions and take a maximum over linear function. So this is a maximum of a family of linear functions of P, right? And you may wonder, like, well, if I take a maximum, then it's harder to differentiate. But actually, it's still relatively easy to differentiate, because you know, there is this nice theorem that says that you know, if you differentiate a function, like the supremum over a family of function, then you the gradient is essentially the gradient of the criterion at the maximum, at this V star. So assuming that you can compute V star, the optimal V here, then the gradient of this quantity with respect to Q is just simply written as the gradient of that at V star. Yes, subgradient. But essentially, right, like it doesn't cost you much, assuming that you can find that you can compute this V star. So, and now, okay, so what I just said is you want a criterion that can be expressed as a maximum over a family of linear functions. And now it should ring a bell, right? Like you should immediately think of it as, well, what is a maximum of a family of linear function? It's a convex function. And indeed, the maximum of linear function is convex, and any convex function can be written as the maximum of over a family of linear functions. So that was, like, you know, motivation for using convex criteria. And now let's look at the particular setup that is of interest here, which is the generative density estimation, where the model that we use is a generative model, which means that, you know, we, like in GAN, we assume that we have some fixed density on some Z space. We map it through some function G, the generator, to the X space, to the input space, and that's what we're trying to optimize. Instead of optimizing the density model directly, we optimize that generator function. And the point is that because we use a generative model, we often cannot compute the density of our model, like the value dq of x for a given x, right? We can only sample from that generative model. And so the idea is that because we can only sample from q, well, we need some sort of a linearity trick for q as well, right? Just like before I was telling you, what makes it work in the normal density estimation framework is that you can write your criterion as a linear function of P. Now I want also a linear function of Q in some sense, right? I want to be able to approximate the criterion from to write the criterion as an expectation so that I can sample from Q and then compute the criterion from those samples. So what I'm saying is that what we really need to do generative density estimation is a function that can be approximated from sample both from P and from Q, so that we can then easily compute the gradients in a stochastic gradient descent fashion. So, okay, the natural conclusion, given what I've said before, is we need distances that are convex, right? So this is, again, because linearity is equivalent to convexity in some sense, or like the as I said before, like the supremum over linear function is convexity. So now let's look at what it means for what are the implications of convexity for probability metrics. So first, let's look at special cases that have been mentioned before. I mean, this is of course not new. You know, f divergences, which can be written in this way with f a convex function, or integral probability. Like I'm glad that previous speakers introduced all these things so that I don't have to define them. Integral probability metrics, which are written in this form, where you take some arbitrary class of function f well, symmetric if you want to not have the absolute value, and Wasserstein distances. Of course, there is some overlap between those three families of distances. There are distances that are both f-divergences and integral probability metrics, like the total variation distance. There are distances that are both IPMs and Wasserstein, like when you take the cost, which is the Euclidean distance, that corresponds to Lipschitz functions. But you can take other costs, and in this case you don't have an IPM, but you have something else. The point is that all these kind of distances here are known to be jointly convex in P and Q. So you can play this trick. There exists some versional representation of this function, which makes it possible to write it as expectation under P and expectation under Q, or the supremum over a class of function of difference between expectations, which of course is obvious here. It's already written in this way for IPMs, but it's less obvious for the other ones. Yet it is possible to write them in this versional form. I mean, the general case, like if you just apply blindly convexity, the convexity definition in some sense, then you can say, well, you know, any of these convex, at least jointly convex functionals of P and Q can be written in this way, where you take supremum over some class of function of the expectation of T under P, expectation of V under Q, minus something that depends on V and T. And that something is the convex conjugate of D. And then we can play the same game, and like then gradients are easy to compute. Now, let's look at a special case, like to see what this all leads to, right? Now, to simplify, let's just consider convexity in P only, right? So we look at the function D of P and Q for a fixed Q, and we assume that it's convex in P, which is the case for all the previously mentioned distances, right? So what we want is to express this as, you know, as a supremum of a linear function, or at least a class of affine functions of P, right? Like this is linear in P, and there's something that depends on T, which in some arbitrary fashion we don't care. I mean, this has been observed actually before by Ruderman and colleagues in an ICML paper, where they were saying that, well, for F divergences, you can get a tighter approximation, a versional approximation, by looking at the convex conjugate. So, and in particular, if you look at the Kullback-Leibler divergence, there are those two ways of writing the versional expression of Kullback-Leibler, which are not exactly the same. There is a log here, an extra log, and what happens is that at the optimum they are the same, right? Like if you optimize over T, you get the same value. It's equal to the Kullback-Leibler divergence. But for any particular T, those two quantities are different. And in particular, this one is smaller, so that means this gives a better approximation of the Kullback-Leibler. So that's relevant, because we know that when we will use this criterion to optimize our density model, we will use a variational approximation, and that's the whole GAN ID, right? That you will take samples from P and from Q and optimize some criterion like this. So if you have a criterion that is tighter, then probably you get a better result when you optimize it, right? So now the question is, like, is there a tightest variational approximation? Well, actually there is, right? Because if you look at this here, right? Like the question is, what FQ should you put here such that this is always like the largest possible for any given T, right? Well, turns out that that's exactly the definition of the convex conjugate. So again, you think of D of PQ as a function of P only, right? So it's a supremum over some class T, some function T, of this minus something, which now you want to plug the optimal such function of T, which is defined like this. It's the convex conjugate of D with respect to P. Okay, so basically the point is, if you want to use a variational approximation, there is a way to compute the optimal variational approximation, assuming that you can compute this this dual or this conjugate. And so let's do it for F divergences. So this is just the definition of F divergences. Some basic properties, they do satisfy non-negativity and zero at P equals Q. And there is an two interesting observations here. One is that when you look at this formulation here, if you change F by adding an affine function of X, right, like lambda X minus one, you don't change the divergence. That's interesting. So you can choose any function of this form, you get the same divergence. Another observation is that because you plug here dp over dq, so it's a density, or I mean a ratio of densities, if you will, so then this quantity is always positive, then you don't care about what happens when f is negative. So you want f to be convex, sure, but what happens on the negative part doesn't matter. So in particular, you can take a function, I call that f plus, which is the convex restriction to r plus. So if you give me any convex function, I can put to infinity all the values that are on the negative axis, and that's still a convex function. So I could replace f by f plus and still have the same divergence. So these are some examples. You know, for Kullback-Leibler, you can take this, reverse Kullback, minus log x, and so on. So now, if you use the standard variational approximation of F divergences, it looks like this. What you do is you take the expression of the F divergence, and you plug in the convex conjugate of F as a function over the real, right? Like, it's not the convex conjugate of the whole thing, it's the convex conjugate of F itself, which is written like this, is the supremum over T of T times dp over dq, minus f star is the conjugate. And now, because you can optimize, I mean, like you can swap in some sense the integral and the supremum, because t can be chosen for each x differently, and that gives you the classical variational formula for f divergences, which looks like this. But what happens is that this term is not the optimal one. It's not the convex conjugate of the divergence df. And so what we can do is we can use this leeway that I was mentioning before, the fact that f can be shifted by an affine function, or that we can take the negative part to infinity. So let's use that leeway. What happens is that if now we replace f by g with this lambda x minus 1 term, the dual looks like that. So it's basically you take f star and you shift it, and you subtract the shift. So that's when you use this part here. And then when you replace f by f plus, what happens is that there is this little lemma here that says that when f is replaced by f plus, then f star, the dual, is replaced by the largest non-decreasing lower bound of the function. So you take f star, and let's say it's a parabola. Imagine f star is a parabola, then f the dagger version of it, the largest non-decreasing lower bound, will be constant and then increasing like this on the second part of the parabola, right? So basically, if you use the leeway I was mentioning, you can replace f by f plus lambda and take the positive part, and what you get is this, right? Like, you could optimize over these possible values of f that you can choose, or the possible variance of f, and if you optimize over the possible variance of f, what you get is something like this. So that's another variational formulation of the f divergence, which looks like this. It's a bit more complicated. You take the f star dagger, right, this largest non-decreasing function, and you optimize over lambda, so you have another parameter to optimize here. And it turns out that now this guy is the conjugate of df, so that's the optimal one. So that's essentially the optimal variational formulation for f divergences. Right. And okay, just as an example, in the case of Kullback-Leibler, you do recover this log expectation of the, I think it's called the don't square Varadhan formulation, that the optimal formulation of a variational formulation of Kullback Leibler. In the chi-square case, it's a bit harder to work out, but at least you can do the optimization over lambda easily. And what you get is the expectation over t squared is replaced by the variance of t. So you get a little, you know, extra shift. All right, and here I have some other intriguing properties of F divergences, which, I mean, some of them are well known, but some of them are less well known. So one of them is that you can, by simply changing F by its what is called its perspective transform, you replace F by this quantity x times f of 1 over x, what you do is essentially swap the two p and q in the divergence. And in particular, if the perspective transform doesn't change f, so if f of x is x times f of 1 over x, then the divergence is symmetric and vice versa. You can reparameterize, that's often done, to view the variational formulation more as a classification problem. When you reparameterize by replacing t by f prime inverse of t, you get some formulation like this, which doesn't look very symmetric, but when f is symmetric, you get something much more symmetric like this, and that you can see as the loss of a classifier, essentially. And the last one is that the metric property, like when do you have the triangle inequality? You do have the triangle inequality for the total variation, which is one of the F divergences, but not for the other ones. But you do have triangle inequality of the square root of the F divergence in some cases. And here, so exercise for the readers. What are the optimal conjugates for all other F divergences? I showed you for KL and a little bit for chi-square, but I did not work out the other ones. What happens in the symmetric case? And another question is, like, what are all the F divergences that are Hilbertian metrics, which means like the triangle inequality is satisfied? All right, so this is the end of the first part. These were like observations of over the criterion that you want to use in when you do generative model, generative density estimation. Now let's switch to boosting. If I still have some time, maybe another 5 minutes.
Yeah, 6, 7 minutes.
Okay. So this is a kind of a different idea, but I will again talk about F divergences and their properties in this context. So if you think of boosting in classification, in the standard classification setting, it relies on the following ideas. You want to not to vote over many classifiers to get a better classifier than a single individual classifier. Let's say you take linear classifier, and you combine them with a vote, and you get something better or at least more expressive. There is this weak to strong idea, which is that if you have an algorithm that produces an okay classifier, which is slightly better than random, then you want to convert it into a strong one, which means that you want to make it arbitrarily powerful. And there is another idea, which is that you do that by using reweighting over the training samples to focus the weak learner on different parts of the distribution. So now the question is, can we apply all these ideas to this other setup of generative density estimation? So what we do is to convert these ideas, we assume that we have some weak learner, which means we have something that I'm not talking about a particular algorithm, I'm talking about the general setup where we have an F divergence and we are minimizing an F divergence, so GAN being a specific instance of that. So assume that we already have some sort of weak learner or something that knows how to minimize the F divergence given some P. And now what we want is to create a linear combination of these weak learners or these simple generative models. It turns out that if you write the model that you want to optimize as a linear combination of models, you still can sample from that. The way you do that, you first randomly, like, you know, these weights alpha are positive and sum to one. So they tell you, like, first you sample, you choose with probability alpha I which I you will use, and then you sample from pi, right? So that's a simple two-step sampling mechanism where you sample which model you want to pick, and then from that model. So you're still in the generative generative setup. And now what you want to do is to do it in a, like, to compute the optimal linear combination or convex combination of models, of simple models, in a greedy fashion, because that's, you know, easier to do. You can do it only one step at a time. And what you do is you first, you know, with your weak GAN, let's say, you optimize the F divergence of the first model, and then once you have trained a few models, then you want to find the next one to add to your linear combination in an optimal fashion. So in some sense, you want to be able to optimize, like, given PG being the already existing combination of models, you want to add a new model, Q, in a convex way, to improve the F divergence with respect to the true data. And you want to find what is the best component to add next. I mean, think of it as a mixture of Gaussian, right? Like, imagine that your data is complex, but you want to fit a mixture of Gaussians. So, and you have some way, and let's say each GAN is just generating one Gaussian, and you want to build the mixture greedily by taking the first Gaussian, and then, like, once you have already built a mixture of Gaussian, you want to find the next Gaussian to add to your mixture. Okay. The thing is that, as I said before, like, this all relies on the fact that you are sampling from your model, and you're computing a criterion by sampling from your model. And if you look at this, if you want to directly optimize that, that means sampling from that combined model here would result in, you know, with probability beta, you would sample from the new component you're trying to build and to optimize. But with probability 1 minus beta, you would sample from the old existing components that you have already optimized. So like, when you compute the gradient of the whole thing, you would only compute the gradient at the points, like, on a fraction beta of the training sample. So in a way, you're wasting a lot of samples on which you will not get any information. So, and especially as you increase your, you know, you add more components to your mixture, you expect beta to become small, because the next component should have should play a smaller role. And as a result, then you know, this will become less and less efficient and harder to tune Q, because you have very few samples to tune on. So the idea is the following. Instead of optimizing directly this criterion, we compute an upper bound. Okay, there are two versions depending on the properties of the divergence. You can upper bound this by something that involves some auxiliary distribution R. And basically, you have two terms, one which is the difference or the distance between Q and R, and another one which is the distance between the current mixture and some function of R, or in the other way, you know, the mixture augmented with R and the true data. And the trick is, once you've written this formula, you can say, well, let me take the optimal distribution R that minimizes this term. You can do it analytically. And then what I'll have to do is to find some Q that approximates this optimal distribution. And okay, so let me just show you what it ends up looking like here. So basically, these are the optimal distributions that you end up if you optimize this upper bound. And this distribution look like this. You take the true distribution of your data, subtract the currently modeled mixture of Gaussians, let's say, or mixture of models, and as much as you can. And if you hit zero, then that's why you have the plus part, the positive part here. Then you set it to zero, and then you rescale. So in some sense, you imagine that you have your tree data, you have already some generator or some mixture of generators that generates parts of your data, but not all of it, let's say. Maybe it undersamples in some space, in some part of the space, and the oversamples in other parts. In the parts where it oversamples, you don't want to sample anymore, so you set this optimal distribution to zero, and in the parts where you undersample, you will rescale so that you will increase the value of this distribution. And this essentially tells you how to resample from your data in such a way to focus on the parts that are not generated yet by your model. And then if you try to fit a new component that fits this resampled distribution, that means this new component will fit the part of the data that has not been generated before. All right, and okay, I don't think I have time to go into details, but basically you can show that under certain conditions on your weak learner, right? Like if your weak learner is able to fit this resampled or reweighted distribution, you can get a stronger learner by combining them in the sense that it will approximate the true distribution eventually. All right, and I think I'm out of time. So these are some illustration of this phenomenon. Okay, I think I'll stop here. This is the algorithm. And some evaluation of how it does. Thank you.